Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How's everybody?
Awesome.
Okay, nothing. How are you doing?
I'm nothing.
Appreciate it, man. It's good, definitely good to be in the house. Be with you guys this morning. Appreciate our brother Zeke this morning for joining us. It's definitely a pleasure to have you, brother.
Blessing for me too.
Amen. Thank you, brother, for that message too. Most definitely. It definitely encourages the simple things of just the gospel and true conversion. It's even encouraging me by yourself. So thank you, brother, for that. Most definitely. If you could turn with me to the book of Romans. The book of Romans. As we are going through the book of Romans, we are in the first chapter of that book. And we'll be looking at Romans chapter 1, verses 11 and 12. But I will read 8 through 12 as that was the series of what we were going through. Let me know when you guys are there. Romans chapter 1, verses 8 through 12. Amen. Paul says this: First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers. Verse 10, making request if by some means now at last I may find a way in the will of God to come to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift, so that you may be established. Verse 12, that is, that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. Let us pray. O God, we come before your throne in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, O Lord, the only name given under heaven, given among men whereby we must be saved. And that's the only way that we can come to you, the only way we have access to your throne, the only way that our prayers are heard is by that name, Jesus Christ, by his sacrifice and what he has done on the cross on our behalf. May we never forget that. Help us this morning, O God. Help us, O Lord. Help me to give your word, O Lord. Preach it in clarity and in truth and in boldness. Give me strength to do so, Lord, and help your people to hear your word, to hear what you are saying. Encourage us, challenge us, Lord, from what you are saying, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, we've been going through the book of Romans, and now we are at verses 8 through 12. As I went through 8 through 10 last week, we talked about how Paul, first, he says, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all that your faith is spoken of throughout the world. We talked about how a true characteristic of a believer is that they're thankful to God for other believers, and not only for other believers, but when the gospel goes forth through other believers. As well, what else? We talked about how Paul made mention of them without ceasing. He says, in verse 9, he says, without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers. Always in my prayers. What was he praying for? Making request if by some means now at last I may find in the will of God to come to you. So he was praying that he might be able to come to them and see them. And like we talked about last week, how this was a church that Paul hadn't even started. This was a church that Paul hadn't even met. And yet he has this kind of affection for them. And the title of my sermon today is The True Functioning Love of the Church, Part 2. Paul's new desires. The true love and function of the church, part two, Paul's new desires. But before we start, I want to talk a little bit about some of what my brother talked about earlier today, about true conversion, about what it really means to be saved. And I won't hang out here long, but I want to hit on what it really means to be truly regenerated and born again. Because if we don't understand this, then the rest of what I'm talking about all these desires, won't make much sense. And they won't really relate or hit home to you. So when a person is truly saved, when a person is truly regenerated, this is when a person, God truly comes down and he saves that person, these are the things that happen to that person. A, they get forgiven. B, they are justified. C, they have a new walk. And D, they have a new heart. And though these are just some of the things that happen. It's not in totality, but these are the things that are the main things or the major things of what stick out to us when somebody actually gets saved. They're forgiven. They're justified. They have a new walk and they have a new heart. So they're forgiven. Well, we live in a day where everyone thinks that as long as you ask for forgiveness, that they have it. Some even think that since Christ has died, everyone just has forgiveness by default. But that is just something that we're entitled to if we ask for it.
Yeah.
No matter how we live, no matter how our life looks like, no matter what kind of fruit we bear, we think that if we sin, and ask for forgiveness in between those sins, we have forgiveness. And that's what kind of day that we live in. But the Bible points us to a different God and to a different idea. You don't have to turn, but in Exodus 23, verse 21, he says, be careful, be sure to obey him. Do not rebel against him, because he won't forgive your transgression. Uh-oh. That sounds something very different from everybody being forgiven. He won't forgive your transgression, since my name is in him. And then just in case you may think that that's a typo or that's the only place where it's at in the Bible, well, Joshua 24:19, then Joshua said to the people, you will not be able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgression or your sins. There it is again. God not forgiving somebody. Well, wait. I thought God was a forgiving God. I thought he was a loving God. I thought just ask for forgiveness and you have it. But here we have in Scripture, there are some people who will not be forgiven. There is a reality that some people will not be forgiven, or some people are not forgiven. God is a holy God. You see his argument. He says you will not be able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He is holy. God does not just let sin go. We sin against the Lord. We commit crimes against his law. And he doesn't just say, well, I'm a forgiving God. You can just go off the hook. It's not just like that. He's not a God that just lets things go. And just in case you think that this idea is only in the Old Testament and not in the New Testament, Hebrews chapter 10, verses 26 through 27, he says, for if we sin willfully or deliberately, after we have received the knowledge of truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sins. Verse 27, but a certain fearful expectation of judgment and fiery indignation which shall devour the adversary. So we see, not from our feelings. This is not how I feel, not my opinion, not just something I'm just conjuring up in my head. But this is from Scripture. That there are some people whose life looks a certain way, and the Bible says they're not forgiven. God is a holy God. He doesn't play with sin. He does not play with sin. He takes sin so serious that God cannot just forgive us. He just can't. And we see from Scripture that everyone is not forgiven from their sins. Forgiveness is only for those who have fully trusted in Jesus like my brother was talking about earlier. And not only that, but for those who have forsaken their sins. Proverbs 28:13. He who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. Whoever confesses and forsakes them. There has to be a confession, and not just confession, there has to be a forsaking that takes place. Those are the ones who will have mercy. Not only those who forsake their sins will have mercy. So if those who forsake their sins will have mercy, then those who don't will have what? They won't be shown. So the opposite is true. If I confess and forsake my sins, I will have mercy. But if I don't, then there will be no mercy which will be given to me, which is synonymous with I will not have forgiveness. And you say, well, I thought all I have to do is just confess my sins and I'll be straight, I'll be saved. Doesn't 1 John chapter 1 verse 9 say, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins? That's what it says. That's the Bible. You're using the Bible, Casey. That's what the Bible says also, right? Well, finish the verse. The rest of the verse says, he says he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, yes, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. See, there's a cleansing that takes place when forgiveness is in the place, is in the picture. There's a certain cleansing that takes place as well. So if there's not a sense in which I am being cleansed from my sins, then I can't have any assurance that I've been forgiven. Any at all. The mark of someone who has truly been forgiven is that they are being cleansed from sins, not that they just confess and ask for forgiveness. B, they are justified. What else happens when somebody is saved? They are justified. Justified. All men have to appear in God's courtroom because all men have and continue to commit crimes against the Lord and his holy law. So we all have to stand in God's courtroom. And where there is no crime against the law, there is no judgment. If I don't go out and commit a crime against the law, I don't have to stand in the courtroom and be judged. But since all men have committed crimes, we all have to stand before the Lord in judgment. And like Romans chapter 5, verse 8, therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, because all sinned in Adam. So judgment comes from sin. But Christ is the lawyer of all who trust in him, all who have all their eggs in one basket, like my brother was saying. Those who trust fully in Jesus, he stands in our place as the mediator.
Yes.
In God's courtroom, and he stands in our place so that we might be forgiven and cleared and declared righteous when we were guilty. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Being justified means that I have been made right with God and that I have been declared righteous in God's courtroom. I have been declared righteous in God's courtroom. So when I was guilty, when I was in the handcuffs, I was bound and shackled, and God says, instead of guilty, he says, listen, a payment has been made for you on your behalf. You're no longer guilty, but you're righteous. Court is dismissed. You're righteous. Because of what Christ has done on your behalf. The perfect life that he lived, the righteousness that is his, he has given to you.
Amen.
And all of your wickedness, all of your sin, all of your filth has been put on him. What does Romans 5:21 say? For he made him who knew no sin to be sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. So those are a few things that happens when you get saved. And see, you get a new walk when somebody gets saved. You live differently, of course. 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things passed away. Behold, all things have become new. You get a new walk. You live differently. Indeed, you get a new heart. And what comes with having a new heart? You have new desires. You have new desires. And as we were saying earlier in Ezekiel 36, he says, I will give you a new heart. God is saying this. I will give you a new heart. If God has not given you a new heart, you don't have one. You can try and change all day. You can do many things to try and make yourself have a new heart in a sense. But if God has not given you a new heart, you are not saved. He says, I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you and remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And another translation says this, and I will give you a new heart and I will put a new spirit in you. I will take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart. A tender and responsive. And what comes with the new heart is new desires, new appetites, new hates, new loves, new wants, and new, excuse my grammar, diswants. New things that you want, new things that you chase after, new things that you're hungry for, and new things that disgust you. Those are the things that comes with a new heart. New things that excite you. New things that give you joy. New things that you love to do. Things that you will seek after. Those are the things that come with having a new heart. Yeah. And not just a new outer appearance. So that's what happens when somebody gets saved. They have a new heart. And we see this in the life of Paul. We see this. And we see this. We see this played out in the chapter that he wrote to the Romans, in the verses that we see right here, verses 8 through 12. We see Paul's new heart and his new desires. Because we've seen the old Paul, when he was Saul, what he was doing, how he was disproving of the church. He wanted to get rid of the church. He didn't want to have anything to do with the church. And if he did have something to do with the church, he wanted to get rid of them. But somebody like that is now writing to a church that he had never met, a church that he didn't establish. So it wasn't like he could say, yeah, you know, I didn't meet y'all, but I established that over there. I'm the one who started that. He hadn't even started that. He hadn't even established that, and he had never met them. And yet he's saying, I'm constantly thanking God for you. I'm constantly praying for you. I want to see you, and I want to encourage you. What can happen to a man that who was once wanting to kill somebody who now is constantly thanking God for them, praying for them, longing to see them and encouraging them?
Yes.
What can happen to a man? That's something out of this world. That's not something that's natural that can happen to a man to make him think and act like this and to write this church of Rome, these kinds of things. So we looked at last time, my first 2 points, how the true function of the church, how the true church interacts with each other. They thank God for each other. The second point was they pray for each other. And the third point, which we will be looking at today and now, is that the true church longs to see each other, longs to be around each other. The true church, anybody who is a true believer in here knows what I'm talking about. You love being around your brothers and sisters. You just can't get enough of fellowship. You love it. You can't get enough. Even this week, you was probably thinking, man, is it Sunday yet? Man, is it Sunday yet? But not even that. Just, man, let me hit my brother up. Man, let me call my brother, a sister. You love being around the body of Christ. That is a mark of a true believer. That is a mark of the true church of Jesus Christ. Look at the first part of verse 11. What does Paul say? Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 11, for I what?
Long.
I long to see you. I long to see you. So we see Paul didn't just thank God for them. He didn't just pray for them, but he longed to see them.
Yeah.
For that's one of the things that he always prayed for, is that he would have an opportunity to see them in person,
yeah,
to be with them where they were. He loved the brethren. He had a heart for the brethren. He had a heart for the brethren that people who were saved even before him didn't even have like that. Paul had a heart for the brethren. And when I read this, when I see this, I'm like, man, this love is a love that is out of this world. It cannot come from anybody but God. God gave this man this love, this deep, genuine affection for the church. God gave that to him. Do you know this love today, my brother? Do you have this kind of affection for the true body of Christ? Do you know this kind of love? Have you experienced this kind of love? Paul says he longs to see them. This longing that Paul speaks of has two major aspects, even three. Number one, you see an inward desire that Paul has for his people, or for this people. See, we can thank God for others and in a sense still not be saved. We can pray for others and in a sense still not, you know, have a regenerated heart. You could fabricate all of those in a sense, but what you cannot fake, what you cannot kind of muster up or manufacture is internal desires that are now natural to you. You can't fabricate that. You can't fake that. You can't make that. You can't make yourself have desires for the true church. You just can't. I can't reach inside of my heart or reach inside of my soul and say, soul, have true, natural, genuine desires for God's people. I just can't. And this is something that has been a work of the Spirit. And if you are not saved, you won't long to be around God's people. You will be, if anything, you'll be in church waiting until the time you get up out of here. You won't long to be around God's people. The God's people, you won't see them as a great benefit to your life or some people who improve and encourage you in your life. You will see them as a hindrance to your life. You will see them as a burden.
Yeah.
Man, why I got to come around them? Oh, here he come with this again. Oh, man, here he come with this Jesus talking again. Oh, man, look at him. He's always talking about Christ. Yes, all right, we know Jesus. All right, let's talk about something else, please. You won't love the body of Christ. You will come, maybe, I know this is the right thing to do. I know this is where I should be, so I'm going to go. But this is not something that you enjoy. Do you have joy in the fellowship of the brethren?
Yeah.
Do you? Check your hearts and see. Because if you're not, you may be in danger. You may be in great danger. Because true people of God have this kind of affection. And every believer in here knows what I'm talking about. Every one of them know what I'm talking about. We love being around each other. And those who are lost, they not only hate being around believers, they love being around the lost. They're comfortable around being around the lost. There's a sense in which they long to be around the lost. What does it say in Psalm? How David says, what did he say? He says, do not be envious of evil people or evildoers, neither desire their company. And that's a mark of an unbeliever, is that in a sense, they desire to be around other unbelievers. They enjoy it freely without conviction. There's another element that we see to this longing in a sense. Number two is that when you long for something, there's this, not only this inward desire, but there's this outward seeking. You seek for what you long for. If I long for something, if I desire something, if something gives me joy, I'm going to seek after it.
Yeah.
So there's this inward desire, this inward love and joy, and there's this outward seeking. Look at verse 13 of Romans chapter 1, the same chapter. Romans 13, and Paul says, now I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that I, what? Often plan to come to you, but was hindered until now. So he's not, I don't just long to see you and just, I'm not just sitting back and doing nothing about it.
Yeah.
No, he's like, no, I long to see you and I'm taking the steps necessary to see to it that I get to see you.
Yeah.
I'm seeking out your fellowship. I'm seeking out this desire to be with you,
yeah,
to be in your presence. Isn't that what John said when he wrote his church? He says, I was going to write many things to you, but I want to come and see you face to face. I'm paraphrasing, but the true believer desires and he seeks it. He seeks it out. And number three, when Paul says this, I kind of get the sense that there's this vulnerability there. There's this sense of openness there. See, some of us are afraid to express our affections for one another because we're afraid of getting hurt in the process. Paul is like, I long to see you there. So there's in the sense in which he's just opening up himself to them. He's not just scared. I'm going to just hold back. I don't want to say certain things to express my affection. I don't want to get too close to them because I might get hurt. And many of us in here are like that. We can be like that. I don't want to get too close because I don't want to get hurt by these people. I don't want these people to get hurt. I've been hurt in the past when I've opened up to people, so I'm not going to open up anymore. And when biblically we do not see that, Paul is just opening up. Hey, I long to see you. I'm praying for you. I want to come over there and be where you at so that I may encourage you and you may encourage me.
Yeah.
And we'll be crazy to think that Paul never experienced any hurt coming from the church world. What happened with Demas? Demas left him. Alexander, what happened? Did him much harm. What happened? So we see this. Many people, and even he has said, I think it was in one part, many people had deserted me. The only person left with me is Luke. So there was harm done to Paul. We see that. And Paul is not just saying or just indulging in his church hurt. Paul's like, no, listen, I still love you guys. I still love the church. I can't help but love the church because God's nature is in me. And if I love God, his nature is in me, I'm going to love his people.
Yeah.
There's no way you can love God and not love his people. It just doesn't happen like that. It doesn't work like that. Our example when it comes to loving people is Jesus. What did he do? Jesus didn't say, well, Judas is going to betray me. Judas is going to hurt me, so I'm not going to let him get too close. Well, Peter is going to deny me, so I'm not going to let him in too much on what I'm doing. I'm not going to express any affection for him. Peter is going to deny me three times. All of the disciples, they're going to desert me when I get arrested, so I'm not going to get too close to them. I'm going to feed them with a long spoon. He didn't say any of that. But took them under his wing, loved them sacrificially, walked with them, taught them, prayed with them, did ministry with them. And guess what? He calls us to love the same way. Because what does it say in John 15:12? This is my commandment, that you love one another, what? Just as I have loved you. So that raises the bar of how we ought to love one another. Not being afraid, oh, this person or that. Yes, we use wisdom in love. I'm not saying don't use wisdom or, you know, for certain unbelievers or things of that sort. There is certain wisdom that we use, of course, especially with unbelievers. But this kind of love that we have for one another, he says, you love them just as I love you. That's a way to say something like that. Because he died. Gave his entire life. So we can't be like, Jesus, I've loved them too much. I don't have any more, Jesus. We hear it all the time. People, you know, when people are confronting people about their sin, they're confronting people about their lack of love, and what do they say? Well, I ain't Jesus. I ain't him. You know, I'm not perfect. I'll do some things for the body of Christ, but I ain't Jesus. And they use that as an excuse for why they are still staying in their sin. But the Bible doesn't give us this excuse. And this is super important. Because this is one of the things where you can tell if somebody really knows the Lord or not. This is one of the ways. Not the very key way, but this is one of the ways. Love for the body of Christ. A love for the body of Christ. And this is one way where we can definitely examine ourselves. And you say, wait, how in the world does me desiring fellowship with believers, how does that help determine whether I'm saved or not? What does that have to do with my salvation. Isn't it just Jesus died, he rose for me, you know, and I believe in that. I believe that that actually happened. So now I'm saved, right? But scripture doesn't leave room for us to just say that and just say we believe that without us doing it and without it being a reality in our life elsewhere. 1 John 5:2, he says, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. And John 13:35 says, by this all men would know that you are my disciples if you love one another. And 1 John 3:14, listen to this. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brother. Whoever does not love abides in death. So now the scripture puts this on the same level as, hey, the same way that you examine this reality, how you see this in your life, has to do with if you're saved or not. If you have passed into death or into life. The Bible is serious about this issue, about us loving one another.
Yeah.
He says, now listen, this can be something that you can just throw out your salvation in a sense. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't just say that, hey, you're just in sin when you don't love God's people, but that you're not even saved if you don't love his people. Let's just lay it down. You cannot have love for God and not his people. Psalm 16:3 says, as for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. David said that. They are the excellent ones, the saints in the land, the ones who follow the Lord, the ones who honor the Lord, the followers of Jesus. They are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. You can't manufacture that. I can't just sit here and just make myself delight in something. I just can't. Either it's there or it's not there. Now there are times when it lacks, there are times when it goes up and goes down, but the reality is for a true believer, it will be there. In whom is all of my delight. Now, unbelievers don't feel like that. They just don't. The fourth thing about the true love and function of the church is that they encourage each other. Let's look back at Romans 1:11. There's the sense in which they encourage one another. Romans 1:11. So he says that, he says, for I long to see you. Okay, why do you long to see them, Paul? That I may impart to you some spiritual gift, so that you may be established. Verse 12, that is, that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me. So he longs to see them, that he may edify them and build them up spiritually. But not just that, but that both of them, that they may build him up too and encourage him as well. And this is true about the body of Christ. We long to see each other because we want to encourage each other. We want each other to be lifted up.
Yeah.
His focus on fellowship is for spiritual purposes. He doesn't say, I just long to be with you just to just be with you, to just talk about just random stuff. He doesn't say, I just long to be with you just so we can just cool out and just chill out and have a good time. Although that's not sinful in and of itself. But we see his focus. He says, I long to see you that I may impart to you some spiritual gift so that you may be established. He has a purpose for why he longs to see them. There's this purpose. Just imagine Paul at a fellowship, or imagine Paul at a gathering together with believers. I can just imagine that whatever is going on, Paul is somewhere looking to encourage somebody spiritually.
Yeah.
He's just somewhere in the midst of it. But in the midst of all the gathering, the festivities and everything, I can just imagine Paul somewhere over there in the side somewhere trying to encourage somebody spiritually. I long to see you because I want to encourage you. I want to build you up. I want to give you something spiritual that I may impart to you some spiritual gift. Nothing wrong with having fun when we fellowship. Nothing wrong with having jokes and things like that when we fellowship. I believe that that's a part of the joy that we experience with one another. We're not sad when we come together, so we just don't laugh or anything. But edification, building up, was his main, one of his main goals when it came to meeting with one another. I mean, there's so much going on in our life. There's so much that we experience. There's so much that our other believers are experiencing and that we're not even aware of. There's so much, and it's so easy for us to get discouraged just going all along with our everyday life. And we must stay encouraging one another. We must stay there. We must have this kind of mind where, man, I want to encourage my brother and sister. How can I encourage my brother and sister? How can I impart to them some spiritual gift? Paul here doesn't just wish to encourage them, but that he might be encouraged too. Look at the end of verse 11. He says, look at verse 12. That is, that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me. Both of you and me. So, wait a minute. He desires that they may be established. And he says, yes, okay, I want to come to you. And he says, wait a minute. You're not just going to encourage me, but wait, Paul, I'm going to encourage you too. Wait a minute, how is that? I'm just a regular old believer. How is that? Well, if we look at the end of verse 11, he says, so that you may be what? Established. Established. What encourages ministers other than to know that the ones who he is serving are established? I mean, I'm sure that when Chavars comes in here and he sees that he's been laboring this whole time, I mean, he's been working and laboring in something, and he sees that, man, this church is getting established, Chavars gets encouraged too. Well, I get encouraged too. Barnes says this, the apostle did not disdain to be taught by the humblest Christians. He expected to be strengthened himself by the faith of those just beginning the Christian life. And listen to this. There is none so poor in the Church of Christ that he cannot make some addition of importance to our stores. Even given the point to where even the newest believer can encourage a believer who has been in the faith for 15, 20 years.
Amen.
Even the newest believer. I mean, there's been plenty of testimonies that I've heard of new believers, and I hear the fire that they have, I hear what happened to them, and then guess what? I get encouraged.
Mm-hmm.
So there's not just this, you know, apostles or teachers or pastors or elders who can encourage people. No, we all have something that we can encourage somebody with.
Yeah.
If we are saved. So we're like, what? No, wait, Paul. Like, isn't your faith way up here and my faith like way down here somewhere? How can I encourage you? Well, that's because they knew that they had the same spirit that he had. Or he knew that they had the same spirit that he had. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, and that they had obtained a faith of equal standing with ours. Look what this, look what Peter says. Turn to 2 Peter chapter 1 real quick, but keep your finger in Romans. Second Peter chapter 1. Now this is Peter writing to those who are dispersed. And this is the Apostle Peter writing. Now, keep that in mind. This is the Apostle Peter writing. And look what he has to say to the church that he's writing to the body of believers that he's writing to. 2 Peter chapter 1. Look at verse 1. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He doesn't say that, hey, my faith is way up here and yours is like way down here somewhere. No, I'm saved. I'm in the faith. You're saved. You're in the faith too. You can encourage me. You can impart some spiritual gift to me. You can encourage me with something spiritual. It doesn't matter. You don't have to be saved 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, or 50 years. You don't have to have went to seminary. If you have obtained a faith of equal standing with the apostles, you know definitely you have something to contribute to the church of God. Definitely. We ought to never think that we're so small to where we can encourage somebody. Even the newest believer in here can even encourage us. I know Chavars will agree to that. Have we obtained this faith, though? I think is the question. But he says, to those who have obtained the faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. Have we obtained that faith to where we are able to encourage somebody? Is there anything about your faith that other believers could be encouraged by? Is there something about you to where when another believer walks in, he can say, man, I've been encouraged. Even if Paul himself were to come in here and to see this church and to be around this church, or if Paul himself met you, could he be encouraged by you? Could the Apostle Paul himself be encouraged by us, by our faith? Could he see us? Is there something about us that, hey, he can be encouraged by? We are called to encourage one another. Luke 22, verse 32, he says, but I have prayed for you. This is Christ talking to Peter. When Satan had desired to have him, when Satan had desired to sift him like wheat, Jesus turns to Peter and he says, but I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. Strengthen your brothers. But look at what he says before. He says, strengthen your brothers. He doesn't just say, I have prayed for you, now go strengthen your brothers. He says, I have prayed for you, and when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. So if you haven't turned, you can't encourage anybody with anything. If I don't have anything going for myself, if I'm still drowning, I can't encourage anybody. If I'm weak too, how can I give strength to somebody else if I don't have it? He said, when you have turned, strengthen your brothers. Within a multitude of counselors, there is safety. But are we even a counselor ourselves? Is there something that we have to contribute to the body of Christ? And not only are we encouraging not only are we encouraging one another, are we seeking to encourage one another? Hebrews chapter 10, you don't have to turn, verse 24 and 25, he says, and let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. We are not just called to meet up with one another and just to have fun and just to see each other. Hey, hi, all right, bye. But to consider how we ought to stir one another up to love and the good works. Yeah. And I was convicted because I'm like, man, I haven't been considering, just taking into thought how I might encourage my brothers and sisters and stir them up to more love and good works. He says, consider how to do that. To consider means to give careful thought to. Meaning that, hey, I'm taking time out of my day to think about how I might encourage the brother. To think about how I might encourage the brother. Whether I'm preaching or not, whether I'm giving the prayer, whether I'm running the prayer meeting or not, whether I am doing the Sunday school or not, am I considering how I might stir each other up? Or how we might stir one another up? So that when we do come together, I'm not struggling, man, how can I encourage them? No, I've already been considering how I might encourage them. So I'm not like, man, they need encouragement. I don't even have anything to say. I need encouragement. But no, we consider. consider how we might encourage them. And in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 through 13, beware, brethren, beware, lest there be any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Verse 13, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you, be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. The writer of Hebrews does not take this as some joke either. But he says, look at the words he's using. Beware, lest any of you have an evil heart, or lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief, departing from the living God. But what's the cure? What do we do about that? Writer of Hebrews. And 13 says, but exhort one another daily. Not just one part or one time or once a day or once a week. But he says, exhort one another daily while it is called today. Yeah. Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Sin can deceive any one of us in here. None of us are to the point to where we can't be deceived by sin. And we need encouragement daily. Yeah. I know I do. I know I do, and I know you guys do. So that's why we're called to do this daily. We're called to encourage one another daily. And that's what Paul wanted to meet up with them for, because he knows the importance of encouragement within the body of Christ. We need to be a body, a church that is thriving. We need to be a church that is moving, a church that is healthy, a church that is effective, a church that is fruitful. But that's not going to happen if no one's encouraging. That will not even be. The true function and love of a church is that they thank God for one another. They pray for each other. They long to see each other, and they encourage each other. And I think if the world seen more of this going on, if the media put out more of this instead of that foolishness that they put out, I think more people, in a sense, they would have a better view of the church than they have right now. Let's turn to Ephesians chapter 4, which will be the last thing that I hit on. I think this is like the golden chapter of the true love and function of the church. Ephesians chapter 4. Just read, and let's just look for things. Look at the true love. Look how the church is really supposed to function while I'm reading this. Versus the church that is portrayed in the media, the church that a lot of us come across today, or a church that we have come across before we were saved. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, he says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the call in which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Verse 4, there is one body and one Spirit, just as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. One God and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all. I'm not rapping, but
that is kind of rap.
That's what it says. So I can guess Paul was a poet too, I guess. No, but for real. So verse 7, but to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Each one of us, every one of us, that's what he's saying, has been given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Verse 8, Verse 9. Now this he ascended, what does it mean but that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is also the one who ascended far above the heavens that he might fill all things. Verse 11. And he gave himself, or he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Verse 12, why are you giving all these gifts, God? Why are you distributing all these gifts and talents? Why? Verse 12, for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. You see protection there too. You see safety there. Verse 15, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling have given themselves over to lewdness, to work all uncleanness and greediness. But you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard and have been taught by him as truth in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which is created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. The true love and function of the church operates like this. And may we ask ourselves, check ourselves, examine ourselves, to see if this is a reality in our life. If we have this true love for one another. Amen.
Amen.